Keep going. Alexander Alexandrovich. Okay, so let's sit down. Hello? Okay. Okay, good. Okay, so we are only an hour late, but that's okay. Okay, so now we have a session on poverty and surviving the crisis, and the first speaker is Francesco Pastore on intergenerational transfer of poverty in Mongolia. So this is our Central Asia or Asia session.
Well, this paper is coming out of research that I've been doing, and in a way, really, it's very simple, almost naive paper. It has a very specific objective, which is in some way to assess the importance of the statement in Millennium Development Goal number one to fight poverty and hunger, and one of the targets to do that is to in some way provide at least $3 a day in some poor countries. So I was thinking, why don't we try to assess in some way what are the effects of living in a country like Mongolia, one of the 50 poorest countries of the world, and living out of a very small amount of money, and what is the difference between living out of $1 or $2 or $3 a month. So I gave the title of a famous Italian song of the 30s, which is I wish I had 1,000 liras. At that time, well, now 1,000 liras is about 50 cents. So it's in some way recalls the idea. Well, Mongolia is one of the 42nd country in terms of poverty in the world. Also, in terms of human development, is one of it does not score so badly. It's 116. I think it's a kind of communist heritage to have quite a high level of education. The median household income is about $85. And about 10% of population lives on $30 a month or less, and 33% about live on $30 through $60 a month. Well, the motivation I was saying is to study what is the impact in terms of poverty for the new generation of belonging to a family where the household income is very, very low. So I was thinking, what is a way to measure poverty for young people? Because this survey is based on this study is based on a survey of young people aged 15 through 29, and provides a lot of information on family background, but also labor market outcomes of these young people. So I thought that one way for young people to measure poverty is kind of deprivation in terms of access to education and also in terms of access to decent jobs. So I thought three ways to see what is the impact of poverty, of living in a poor household on youth poverty, is to look at the probability to drop out of school or probability to fall into educational marginalization, which, as we'll see in a second, is having a level of education which is in the 20 lowest part of the distribution. And working poverty is getting a salary that is below the poverty line. So this is obviously hinting at the existence of poverty traps in these countries, because if the poverty of fathers and mothers goes into their children, this is going to last forever. And therefore, it's a way to assess the importance of, for instance, policies of cash transfers to local population, all which are very small, and how they could, what would be the effect of this cash transfer. So, of course, it's not enough probably to just give some money to poorest families to let them overcome their status. But this is, in some way, the idea behind this simple paper, as I was saying before. Methodology, I'll show the methodology, I'll discuss shortly the data used, and then I'll show some findings which are simple estimates or determinants of these three phases of poverty for young people. I will give some concluding remarks. On methodology, it's always an outcome that we already discussed before, dropping out of school, educational marginalization, working poverty. And I use as determinants a number of variables. I should say that this specification is really, I'm not an expert of the literature on intergenerational transfer of poverty, but cannot see around many studies about that. I mean, determinants of poverty at an individual level. And therefore, that is mainly based on intuition and data availability. So I think of individual poverty as also a consequence of individual characteristics, age, civil status, working while at school, main goals in life. This is a specific aspect of this survey, which I thought it was interesting to use, because in some way, it's young people are asked to say what are their main aspirations in life. So I see in this kind of question a way to assess some non-cognitive abilities, some degree of motivation. I don't know if I'm wrong, but it is one way of thinking in terms of catching something different, which is not education, and that's not necessarily some family background, maybe also some more individual factor, like more talented people can be also in families with lower income levels. So in some way, with these variables, I think I can catch some ability factor. And then also place of residence. Then I control for some family characteristics, which are number of siblings, being a orphan, I mean, being a motherless or fatherless, parents' education, and then the key variable in terms of policy implication is, of course, the fact of belonging to a family whose household is $1, $2, or $3 a day. The data used. This is an ad hoc survey which was run in Mongolia by the ILO together with the National Statistical Office, and actually it has been run also in other seven countries, developing countries. If somebody's interested, this data is available online. It includes Azerbaijan, Egypt, Syria, and a number of other countries. And as far as I know, the ILO is running it also in other 27 countries in the developing world. So it's kind of interesting source of information if you are interested, especially in young people, labor market outcomes. Generally, in fact, the sample is essentially very young people. It was carried out in 2006, it's a cross-section. And the questionnaire got information about education and training, families influencing career choices, perceptions and aspirations, as we were saying before, job search, processes, barriers and support for entry into the labor market, and also labor market outcomes, including wages and preferences for self-employment and other working conditions. So it's very detailed questionnaire providing a lot of information. So let's go to the first dimension of poverty for young people. As I said before, this is the probability of dropping out of school. Here is meant not only people, it's included in this group, all those people who are left school before completion of high secondary school, not for normal courses, so including also having achieved the desired educational level. And we can see that distribution by reason for to leave school, you immediately see that economic factors are very important. Schools in Mongolia, Mongolia is a very dispersed country, population is 10 million, I think, people, but the size of the country is very big, probably like Europe or half Europe, I cannot remember exactly, but quite big, I would say. So it's a problem for many young people they live in peripheral regions, in peripheral areas, so it's very difficult to get access to education for most of them. And so this dropping out of school is one of the biggest problems, according also to international organizations. And I would say it's one of the main research issues of literature, economic literature and sociological literature in this country. So there is some focus on that. And the factors all hint to the, probably to the economic factors, the economic reason. Although this is never explained in a direct way, but we know that, for instance, dropping out is higher for men than for women, and the main reason is that men are more frequently involved into herding. So they tend to have more frequently child labor than women. This is a difference of Mongolia with respect to other countries. And in fact, taking care of livestock is one of the main reasons for dropping out of school. It's the main reason, actually, especially for men. And also other factors, if you think in terms of economic reasons, they are linked to economic reasons. The need to work, economic reasons, in fact, also, do not enjoy schooling if you read that there is a literature on dropping out of school in Mongolia, you can see that it is typical of poorest families to experience bullying at school. So the richer people tend to exclude the poorest groups, and therefore this is one of the main reasons for dropping out of school. So what are the determinants of dropping out of school if we look at the factors that I mentioned before? Well, first of all, well, here is in log odds ratio, so value higher than one is positive and the lower than one is negative. So you have that especially dropouts is, of course, I mean, the older the age of people, the more frequent is probability that they drop out of school for normal reasons. Civil status does not seem to affect very much. Probably here it's not exactly exogenous, because we cannot distinguish whether the civil status was achieved before or after dropping out of school. We can find though some impact of women with children, they have lower chance of dropping out, but again, this probably is due to the fact that women start having children after finishing school and finding a job, probably. And then I immediately present the main variable of interest, which is the income level of the household. And we can find already that having like less than $30 a month means having a probability of dropping out of school four times ceteris paribus than the baseline group of people living in households with more than $100 a month. Also, household characteristics are important if we think at them in terms of, for instance, household members. The greater is the number of household members, the higher is the probability to drop out. Having being fatherless or motherless is also an important factor. And the education of father and mother, especially mother, is affecting in an important way the probability of dropping out of school. And coming to the, well, working while at school is not, actually it tends to increase in some cases it tends to reduce probability of dropping out of school, probably because it's a way to support your own education. So the if you work part-time in the service sector or other types of work, you're probably more likely to continue your studies because you get some financial support. Aspirations in life seem to have some to play some role in terms of probability of dropping out of school, and especially hoping to have a lot of money in life is to gain more money is in fact related positively, strangely enough, with probability to drop out of school. So it means that many people that think it's best way. I mean, the most important thing to earn money, they think that education is not the right way to do that. So instead, having a good education, of course, is affecting negatively the probability of dropping out of school and also making a contribution to society. So it's kind of measure of some social return to education in some way. So individuals that think that it's important to make a contribution to society, they tend to drop out less frequently than average. Gaining a reputation instead, again, it's increasing the probability of dropping out. And also, it's typical, especially in the urban areas, to go to school. So the more you go to the rural areas and to small cities, small towns like Zoom centers, the higher is the likelihood to drop out of school. The second variable is, as I said, the educational marginalization. Actually, this is just a slightly different way of thinking of the previous variable, because again, education, it's surprising to see the answers to this questionnaire by young Mongolians. They think that education is, a very high share. I was surprised. I think not even in Western Europe we have such a high share of people that want to finish university education. Although these aspirations is realized only by a small share of people, but it's very strong, the idea that education is important for the average young Mongolian. And so I thought it will be an important sense of deprivation for many young people if they can only hold a very low level of education. Like this is a category introduced by the UNESCO in the Global Monitoring Report on Education for All. And they use this concept of educational marginalization, which is holding a level of education which is below the 20% of the educational distribution, which is defined in this case of Mongolia. I did it also for the other countries, but here it's Mongolia. It's essentially people that finish with primary or basic education according to whether they are in the age group 20, 24, 25, 29. I focus especially on the oldest age group, because at that time educational attainment is already completed in some way, so I thought it's the best group to consider. Again, variables are very similar to dropout. Also, the variable of interest here, which is household poverty, it's just slightly lower, so we have a greater impact of household poverty on the probability to drop out of school rather than to cause educational marginalization. So it's slightly smaller, the coefficient 2.4. And the other variables also are relevant. I mean, the size of the family, having being fatherless or motherless, and the educational level of fathers and mothers. Educational aspirations, again, we can see that the correlation is very similar to the previous one. We see that making a contribution to society is leading young people to thinking that this is the main goal in life, is leading young people to be less educationally marginalized, whereas thinking that it is important to make money, to have a lot of money, is increasing the probability of educational marginalization. And also having a good family life, especially for women, This is related positively to the probability of educational marginalization, also gaining a reputation, strangely enough, and living freely, which is just a way to think not to have obligations in life. For young people, it's quite, for some young people, is an important aspiration. And again, living in peripheral areas is a factor of marginalization. And the last regression is about working poverty. So living out of an income, working in a job that provides you with an income that is below the poverty line. It means a job which we would call not decent, a decent job, which is quite common actually in Mongolia. The share of non-decent jobs is quite large. And what we find here, we introduce also some educational variables. Of course, they are related to education. So it reduces with the increasing education. But again, here the impact of household poverty is even bigger than the previous one. We have very high coefficients, 20% higher chance of being a working poor if you live in a family with an income which is less than $30 a month. And also the number of siblings is affecting your probability of working poverty. And education of father and mother seems to be less important, actually. And also aspirations. The main aspiration that is correlated to working poverty is having a good family life. So if you aim to have a good family life, you tend to be more frequently into working poverty. Again, in the rural areas, probability of working poverty is higher than in the capital city of Ulaanbaatar or in the IMAG centers, which are kind of regional capital. And what are the conclusions? Conclusion is that the household background, in terms of not only education of father and mother, but controlling for this variable in terms of poverty, is strongly associated with the risk of poverty for the young generation, hinting at massive processes of intergenerational transfer of poverty. All household characteristics appear to importantly affect the youth poverty status, suggesting that poverty traps might be in place in Mongolia. And the main finding of the paper, I think, is that living in a household with less than $1 a day has a probability 4 times greater of dropping out of school, 2.5 times greater of being educationally marginalized, and 20 times of being working poor. And therefore, this is, I would say, quite strong support in favor of the policy of cash transfers from also abroad, probably, or from the government, in favor of these poorest families in the country. So this is.
Thank you very much for also staying in time and being very concise. So, are there any comments, questions?
What fraction of the population are in those households on living in on $1 a day?
10%.
10%. I see. So your motivation about the intergenerational transmission of poverty is I think very apt for the dropping out of school and being educationally marginalized. Although I have to admit I didn't quite understand the definition of that, but those are impressive results. But the last one about being working poor, so that means the wage of this young person is in some poverty range.
Yes, below the poverty
line. Right, and
the defined like below 25% of the average income, not of households but of young people.
Okay, but the right-hand side variable is the same as in the previous two. That is, it's the current household income.
Yes.
Right? So the way this is worded here, born in a family living out of more than $3 a day, so it's actually their household income, which includes presumably their wage.
No. It's different. I mean, household and the income of the individual. But it's a different
thing. Isn't the individual's income part of the household income?
No, I don't think so. I mean, as far as I understand.
So it's subtracted off?
I would check this.
Okay, well, even, okay, so even if it, usually household income includes all the income of the, you know, everybody who lives in the household, but in any case, suppose it's subtracted off. I mean, this is just telling you that poor people live together, isn't it? It's not, that's less about the intergenerational transmission than the first 2 points, in a way.
It's more like a kind of group.
Well, you know, so if this young person has moved out and is living on his or her own, then whose income is that in the household?
Probably they mentioned also because in Mongolia it's quite common to go out of the family quite early. They marry quite early, so the age of 21, women have children. Actually, in Mongolia, there is not even concept of marriage, as what I was explaining, in the sense that they are very young people are very, very easy at marrying and divorcing. So the divorce rate is very high, simply because it's not a formal marriage. It's just living together. There is not concept of marriage. There is concept of living together. So, my understanding is that it's not part of the household. The income of the young person, it's the wage income, which is not including the parents' income.
Well, okay, but that household income is measured at the same time as this person's wage?
Yes.
Yeah, the same time. So if this person's moved out of the household, out of his or her parents' household, living alone, for example,
yes,
then that household income is his or her income.
It's an income of the parents.
So it's actually the parents' income.
I guess so, but I will not test this.
Are there any other questions? Comments? No? Yeah.
So we had a... from our department, they just went to Mongolia and explained what the Mongolian society looks like. And from their presentation, it looks like, at least in Western Mongolia, that you have people living yurts. So, and dropping out of school is very highly correlated with the distance to the school. So, because when you live in the yurts, I mean, and then school is too far to go, but you don't have that information, right? So if individuals, what's the distance from the yurt to the school location? But another thing was household income, right? I don't know how they calculate the income here, but there it's like more of a, I own 50 horses, you own one, so you're poor. So the definition of having income is very different. And so, I mean, you mentioned taking care of the livestock, so that's very important for young men especially. Because that's that's their wealth. I'm richer because I have, and my parents are gonna leave 50 horses, yeah. So, and I'm gonna marry. So that's more of a predictor of wealth than regular like monetary income, let's say. So I don't know how you calculate income here, but I would say if you control for, you know, the number of livestock at least, but I don't know if you have that information.
There is this kind of information. I think your point is very important because it's true. I was also told that actually the income is essentially time. The wealth of the family is a measure in terms of livestock and so on. So also to school fees are paid in terms of meat.
Yeah.
So if you want to go to school, you have to bring, let's say, 2 kilos of
Well, that's how marriage market works as well.
So
it's in terms of livestock.
It's very, so it's here. It's essentially monetary.
Because I think for nomadic societies, the typical standard definition of household income and consumption are very different than, let's say, developed modern societies. So because they, first of all, they move a lot because you have really harsh shocks, especially in the wintertime in Mongolia. So people are moving to take care of the livestock because they could die, right? The livestock could die, so they want to move away from these, it's called zoot, I don't know, that's what they told me, these harsh winters when it comes to take care of the livestock. So they're moving from one point to another, so that in itself will disrupt the schooling process for young men or women.
Probably an idea would be to focus only on people living in the capital city or...
Yeah, that would be different than Ulaanbaatar. It's more Soviet-style buildings, more or less, high, tall.
See, or the IMAX centers.
IMAX centers, yes.
Yeah, may I have the question? I just wondering, what's the rate of return of education in Mongolia? That's first question. And the rate of return to education in Mongolia is higher or is relatively lower? Its benefit to go to school is not at all. And how pervasive the widespread the child labor in Mongolia is widespread or it's a rare incident in Mongolia, the child labor. Yeah, and the last question is about in your data, do you have any exogenous shock to income, like the government transfer or the international aid to the poor people that help you to see how important the increased income to disrupt this kind of international intergenerational transmission?
I don't think we have information about this, about aid, but there are programs to also reduce dropping out of school and also providing transfers to families, but they are not recorded, as far as I know, to this survey. Education is, I would say, surprisingly high if you expect that in the country the educational level is very, very low. But they have some problems, like about 4 or 5% of, especially men, drop out of school without any kind of education, without even primary education. And the share of people with the university degree is very low by internet, but not that low, probably. I think it's about 15% for among young people. So it's not very, very low. In fact, as I was saying at the beginning, in terms of educational level, Mongolia is not performing badly in the international comparison, and not as bad as in terms of incomes.
So how about rate to return to education?
Return to education is in Mongolia, well, not that low. I mean, it's quite high. It's about 5-6% per year. So it's, I would say, more like a middle-income country rather than a developing country where generally returns to education are much higher. So probably this might explain, on the one hand, also the relatively high level of education if you consider the structure of production, which is very traditional, based mainly on agriculture and herding, and so I think probably, but still education is perceived, I mean, in terms of the stock of education, it's not probably not that bad not to have enough education, but in terms of perception, aspirations for young people, it is quite, it's perceived as a kind of deprivation not to be able to access education. That's my point.
Okay, are there any other comments? So let me ask you something or comment, I don't know. I mean, it strikes me, first of all, it's not clear to me why those two, because let's forget about the third, dimension of poverty. Why the first two are the main drivers of poverty in Mongolia? I can understand that in a developed country, dropping out of school, having low human capital, having low education might really, you know, this will increase your likelihood of being unemployed, and thus you will have a high, much higher probability of being poor. But as what was said, Artem was saying this. Artem, is it? No. Bahram, sorry. As he was saying, you know, the economic structure is very, 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 very different. So maybe if you have, you know, 50 cows or 50 whatever cattle, you can drop out of school. This doesn't, you know, this doesn't matter. But then, so wealth is what, you know, so wealth is perpetuated or whatever. But you know, so the issue is it really so that these are the drivers of poverty in a country like Mongolia? And I think it's just sort of mechanically applying normal models of poverty generation to maybe a context that's quite different.
Proxy of the wealth also, probably, like generally is the case, is there some proxy also of income that the household is having some proxy of the wealth. But I understand that probably more in the capital cities is more important monetary factor than in rural areas where probably they are not important at all. So in fact, there are strong differences in the residence of individuals. I mean, we can see also in these estimates that coefficients for living in rural areas are very, very different. I mean, very high, so probably all the estimates, all the coefficients are different in this area. So probably it's a good suggestion to focus or to disentangle these two groups and people living in suburban areas or rural areas and in the capital city. In fact, there was an interesting survey run by the Korean Institute of Economic Research in Mongolia, and they did it only in Ulaanbaatar, because Ulaanbaatar is more similar probably as in terms of economic structure to what we think of economic system.
Okay, so are there any other questions, comments? No? So I'll invite Zhong to present his paper on how Chinese migrants survived the crisis.
Thank you very much for inviting me. This is joint work with co-author Jin Liu and it's from China. Yesterday and today we talk a lot about the Russia and other Central Asian countries. And this is the one paper in China. So in China, we're talking about especially the group of the migrants. So, I will follow the outlines. So first of all, I think it's important to talk about of the institutional setup in China. So how the China work, what's the migrants situation in China, okay? And then we're talking about the data and some results. And of course, the paper is kind of in progress, so it's really preliminary. So I think it's a good time that to get feedback to see how we should proceed and from the general framework and also for the small details. So in order to understand the migrants in China, especially the rural people who migrate to urban to work, we need to understand one of the system in China. It's called the hukou system. I don't know whether Russia has the same system before or not, but the system basically it still exists today. It's a legal system, it's kind of resident permit that each person must have a resident permit. And as long as you're born in China, the government divided people into two categories. One is the urban people, and the other is the rural people. And officially, it's really hard to change the categories. It's almost impossible for the rural people to get the urban hukou and vice versa. Of course, there's several channels, but in practice, the probability of the change the hukou from one category to another category is quite low. Okay, that's one thing. A lot of resource allocation is tied to the hukou, to the systems. For example, for the urban people, they enjoy the social welfare assistance in the urban area, like the public health care and the pension, and sometimes in the old time, the guarantee of a job and the allocation of an apartment. But nowadays, it's gradually relaxed, but there's still a considerable amount of the social welfare tied to the hukou system. And for the rural people, they can entitle to a piece of land, for example, so they also enjoy some the allocation, the resource from the government. Okay, so basically, the hukou system have a long history. It actually established in the 1950s, and the main purpose of that time is to restrict people move from the rural area to the urban area. So after the reform, of course, this restriction gradually released, but still it's a big institution barrier for the labor mobility within China. Okay. So that's one thing to understand the hukou system. So because the hukou system and the other policies, the chairman are divided by the rural and the urban. I will show you a picture to see. It's the picture, okay. The pictures show the income of the urban people over the rural people, okay. So from the 1978, the start of reform until now, 2010, the urban people have a considerably higher income than the rural people, as large as three times in the last almost 5 or 6 years. So the gap are kind of increasing until recently. Okay, until recently it's dropped after 2008 or 2009, but we still don't know. It's kind of data problem with a kind of the convergence from the rural to urban side. So that's the key factors to understand why there are so many migrants in China from rural to urban area, because basically there's a huge of the income gap. The others, besides the rural urban division disparities, the regional disparities are quite large in China also. There are very rich places like Shanghai and Beijing, and also the very poor province like the Guizhou and the Tibet and some place like that. So in this picture, I show you the fine lines, the dark line in the middle, that's the per capita GDP of the whole China, okay? And then for the top two lines, the red line and the blue lines, the Beijing and the Shanghai, that's the per capita GDP. And the bottom two lines, they are the Guizhou and the Gansu, they are the kind of the lowest per capita income in China, and the per capita GDP income. So you can see the gap is substantial. Okay, so there are two factors. One is a huge of the disparity between urban and China, and the other is the development level and also the income, the GDP growth rate, etc., have a quite of the regional disparities, especially, generally speaking, okay, the inland are less developed and the coastal area are relatively well developed. Okay, because these two factors, so we see a lot of migrants that move from rural area to the urban area, and they also they move from the inland province to the coastal province. So the number quite large. By the end of 2009, 2008, okay, this is the first official statistics released by the National Bureau of Statistics. Before that, nobody knew how many migrants in China. Okay, so that's the first set of the official statistics that tell us how large is the migrant population. When I'm talking about migrant population, I mean the people have the rural hukou who work in the urban cities. Okay, so I exclude other migrants. Like for the urban people, migrants other place, they are not in these figures. They are only the figure here only include the people from rural to urban. Okay, so the number is quite high. It's kind of 140 million of the migrants by the end of 2008, but it's still increasing. But because the hukou system I just mentioned, the migrants, even though have a huge number of them, but they have a little entitlement in the urban area, the access to the social welfare system in urban areas is quite limited. And also because the resource allocation is according to the hukou, whether they are urban people and they are rural people. So for these migrants, even if they are working in the urban area, they still have a piece of land back in the village. So this makes the migrants are really hard to assimilate into the cities. They always think the city is a temporary place for them. So they don't have a long-term goal to stay in the city, and they always think the village is the home community as the last resort if something happens in the cities. And also they don't enjoy the same social benefit. They also don't entitle the same labor protection in China. So basically, the labor market in China are still segmented, okay? For the same people, whether you have an urban hooker or not, or have a local hooker or not, make a big difference. On average, if we look in the data and to calculate the hourly wage of the migrants and the urban people, roughly, the hourly wage of the migrants is around 50 to 60% of the urban people, but the monthly wage is around 70 to 80% of the urban people. The gap for the monthly wage is smaller because the migrants work more. They work much, much more. They work around 60 to 70 hours per week. Okay, so because the migrants, I just mentioned, they're quite more vulnerable to the shock, so it's an important subject to now study. We'll try to understand what's going on if this group of people experience the exogenous shocks. That's one thing. And the other thing is, I just mentioned, it's a huge number of them. Actually, it's the major labor force of Chinese manufacturing sectors. It's largest labor force of the Chinese manufacturers. Without the migrants, the China is no longer the manufacturer of work. So it's kind of important to understand what's the response, what the migrants will respond to this exogenous shock. And so that's the purpose of these studies. So I just mentioned that the migrants usually work in the manufacturers. They do what kind of things, the toil and the construction. Okay, so sometimes they're self-employed. So like the garbage collector and have a small shop, etc. So basically, a lot of people in China consider the migrants as kind of concentrate in the low-skill segment of the urban labor market. It's like the... okay, so that's the general picture of the migrants and the institutional context of the rural urban migration in China. So in these papers, we ask a really strict forward questions. What happened after 2008? Who survived the financial crisis? Okay. Which factors, what kind of characteristics can increase the probability of the migrants stay continue to stay at the job at the cities? Okay. Because in the 2008, there's financial crisis, and in China, the manufacturing sectors are affected most because the China is kind of the manufacturers exported oriented. Okay. So after the financial crisis, the demand from abroad decreased, so the manufacturing sectors are hit most. And the manufacturing sector is happened to be the sector which migrants are concentrated. Okay, so what we do, we're using the data, it's a kind of unique data collected by an international survey team with the help from different organizations, including the contribution from the IZA. Okay, so it's supposed to be a panel data. It start collect data in 2008 and plan to do a panel, but now we have a full wave already. So in this study, I used the first two waves. I used 2008 and 2009. But basically, all the variables, characteristics, I only used in the 2008 one. I used 2009 just to see who is still in the sample, in the sense who still survive after crisis. So you see, originally, the sample is size that is about 5,000 households. Okay. So after the second wave, we are only have less than 2,000 left remaining the samples. So the attrition rate is high, but of course it should be noted not all the migrants not remain the sample due to the financial crisis. There's a normal attrition even if there's no financial crisis, because the migrants in China just mentioned they are considered the city as a temporary place. There are a lot of secular migrants that are going from one place to another place. So even if there's no migrants, they still have a relatively high attrition compared with other panels. Okay, so this is the part we'll try to disentangle in the papers. So this is the China and this is the survey regions. So basically we have the data from the 15 cities. So the coastal area, that's a relatively rich area, and the inland are the relatively poor areas. So the migrants are basically moved from the rural to urban, from the inland to the coastal areas. Okay, so then based on the whether the migrants are still in the sample in 2009, we divide the 2008 sample into two parts. We call them survive and attritors. Okay, so basically, that is the descriptive statistics. I have a relatively small set of variables, the household characteristics, include age, the gender, etc. So we see that the age kind of there are 2 years difference between the who survived, the survivor a little older than the people who are treated from the sample. And there are also difference between whether the household are married or not. But for the education level, it's quite similar. And the network size is different. For the survivors, they have a relatively large network size. And I'm also looking into the other household variables. Okay. So for the household variables, basically look into two things. One is the family size, and the other is number of children. Let's define the family size and the number of children is defined as the people who come in the cities, not include the people left in the village. So only include the people in the cities. Okay. Also the total income, that's also, you know, defined as the city household income, not include possible income from the villages. The one variable reflecting the resource in the village is the land size in the village. So we didn't see much difference in the land size, but in later extent, it's kind of important. So I just said the attrition of the migrants sample from 2008 to 2007 can be at least due to factors. One is the financial crisis, And the other is, even if without financial crisis, we probably can still witness a lot of people cannot track over time. So we try to see whether we can separate these two. So we, here we have two models. One is we do a probit models. Okay, so the independent variable is whether you're still in the sample in 2009. Okay, so this model will didn't separate whether you attrition is due to financial crisis or just the normal attrition. And the other models is in the literature is called the partial observability models. I will talk a little bit later. And for that model, it will help us to try to separate these two components. But of course, there are some something underlying. It's not the most satisfactory model we are satisfied, but if somebody have a suggestion, you're welcome to inform us how to do it better. But I will talk this a little bit later. And in the regulations, we also control other things. We control for the safety dummies and for the industrial dummies. Okay, so that's the setup. And now analyze is quite simple. So first, we run a basic probit model and to see which factors are contributing to the survival or to the people's remain in the migrant samples from the 2008 2007. So we see some factors are not important, the age or the gender of the household, but some factors turned out significant, like the education level, whether you're working on long hour or not. Probably that reflects how hardworking the people it is. If the people work longer hours, they will likely to stay at the city longer. Okay, then the network size also help, and for the household level characteristics. Okay, if the family size are larger and if the household has more children, it's turned out to drop out the sample more likely drop out the sample. That probably reflect during the financial crisis. So if you have a big family, you need more resources to maintain the family, and that will be difficult. So probably it's better for them to go back to the village. One thing it's interesting is the land size. Okay, it's the land size at the village. Okay, if you have a relatively big size of the land in the village, in the financial crisis time, it also tend back to go back to the village. Okay, because probably you can better use your labor in the village because you have more land in the village than waste your time at the cities. So of course, this is just a simple probit model I just mentioned. It didn't separate the attrition from the normal attrition, or even without the financial crisis, or the attrition caused by the financial crisis. Okay, so then let's come into the partial observability models. So what the model says is that the model says, okay, first we have two indicators, we call it Y1 and Y2. Let's say the Y1 is normal attrition, okay, in the world of no financial crisis. And the Y2 is the attrition caused by financial crisis. Okay. But in the data, we only observe people whether they are in the data in 2009 or not, but we don't know whether we only observe the product of Y1 and Y2. That means we know the people are not in the sample or still in the sample, but we don't know whether the people dropped the sample because of normal attrition or because of the financial crisis. Okay, so this is the partial observability models. So in the literature, it's older literature about these models. Basically, it's boiled down to a bivariant probit models. Okay, but of course, this model is quite old already. That's why we kind of feel not really satisfied with the model, but we didn't find a better one yet. Okay, so it's rely on some strong assumptions, and nowadays it's kind of unpopular in the economics empirical studies. Basically, we specify two selection equations, Y1, Y2, and then we assume the algorithm of the two equations have bivariate normal distributions. That's the underlying assumptions. If under that assumption, and also we have some exogenous shock, can be, you know, like variations which affect one equation but another, we can identify the models. So the identification here we use here is that the financial shock is not universal. It's not uniform across cities and across the occupations. There's quite variations across cities and also across variations. This is the table prepared by Kong, Meng, and Zhang. So this is the people who collect the data. Okay, so the first column is the 15 cities, and the first row is the occupations. This is the number of the workplace closed due to the financial crisis. Well, not really due to financial crisis, but it's during the 2007 to 2009. The most important reason is the financial crisis if the workplace closed. So, before I talk this paper, let me tell you a little bit the survey so you can understand what the table tells us. Okay. Because when the people do the survey in China, it's really hard, or in any other countries, it's really hard to survey the migrants. In China, we basically know the sampling universe. We know sampling framework to do that. Then the survey teams try to design a sampling framework. So first, they choose 15 cities. Then they divided the city into blocks. Then they randomly sample the blocks within the city. And for the sampled blocks, they do the census of the workplace in that block, in the sampled block. Okay, so from the 2007 surveys, from the 2007 census, they know exactly how many workplace in the sampled blocks and the distribution across the manufacturers and across the cities. And after financial crisis, okay, so they suspect it will affect the whole distribution of the workplace. Many of them should probably will close down. So they do a sampling of the workplace they use in the census. They didn't do the census in 2009. They just do the sampling because it's too expensive for them to do the census again. So they do the sampling and they found that indeed some of the workplace are closed. But we see a lot of variation across the cities and across the manufacturers and across the industrials. This the number of the workplace closed. And this is the percentage across the cities and also across the industrials. So the two tables, this is not identification source, okay? Now identification is based on the valuation from the shock. So we use this as the measurement for the shock. So the valuation of the shock at the city level and at industrial level, that's not identification source for the partial observability models. Okay, so this is not estimation for the partial observability models for the equation two. For the equation two, basically, we see that the results are quite similar with the not previous results on the probability models, but some variables, the effect of some variables are getting stronger, For example, the network size, okay, the the coefficients are kind of larger compared with the previous one. And we also observe some other variables that are similar patterns, like the educations, the sign is the same as before, but the absolutely size are increased. Okay, so this is basically what we have now. As I said, now main worry is about the model is not is rely on the parametric assumption. It's old fashioned, but it's not really popular now. So, but in the future, probably we'll try to get more variable into the models. So now the variable is still relatively small set of variables. In the data, we still have some variable on the personality and also on the labor protections. So that will help us to see, besides the personal characteristics, what's the institutional protection to give to the migrants. Okay, probably we also need to study a little more about the subgroup. For example, is the migrants on the first job or on a second job? Is the first episode of migration with the, you know, the second or afterward of the episode of migration? Okay. Of course, the final part we didn't do, we plan to do is that we want to compare the people are still in the sample from both 2008 and 2009 and see the main outcome variables change or not, how they change because of the financial crisis. Okay, that's what I want to present. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you, John. So are there any, Bologna?
Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. Probably I missed and you said that, but nevertheless. What is the proportion of migrants in the urban labor force? And what is the proportion of migrants with rural huku among all migrants? Could you tell us anything about that? Probably, but I was probably missed this.
Yeah, I think for the figure here, all the people here, the 140 million people, are the people with the Zohuko who work in the cities. Okay, so all of them are migrants. Okay. So in China, we divided the Zoh people who work in the city into two categories. One is the migrants, so they live in the city, not at home. So this is the number here, and roughly we have another 1 million or so, or 100 million or so of the Zoh people who work in the urban sectors and in urban area, but stay at home. Okay, for all this we call them the urban people who work at the Zoh, for the Zoh people who work at urban areas, but total, if we put these two categories together, there are around 206 million labor force from the rural areas. That's what kind of more than half the Chinese urban labor force.
And this is the 140 million. It's a stock indicator of load indicator. It's very important.
It's a stock at end of 2009.
Okay, so can you elaborate a little bit more about the labor market segmentation in? So the urban residents, they operate in essentially in a non-competitive labor market because trade unions are important, what generates the rent that urban workers get that
now the study suggests basically the urban people, rural people are not compete each other mostly. Okay, of course, for the a small segment, probably they do. There are two reasons. One is the institutional barriers. Okay, so even just several years ago, 2 years, 3 years ago, but now it's changing. Legally, there are a lot of local government that require for certain job, they require local hukou to apply. Okay, if you don't have a Beijing hukou, for example, probably cannot apply for a job at the same university. Okay, so that's one restriction. Okay, that's tied with the hukou. And the other is more related to the endowment of the peoples. Because China is segregated by the hukou I just mentioned, and this creates a lot of disparities between the urban people and the lower peoples. For example, the education level are totally different for the urban people and the lower people and the rural people. The rural people, most of them only have a high school at most degrees. I guess less than 1% or 2% to go to college. But in the urban sectors, it's totally different. So the skill level and education level are quite different. And also in China, during the reform transition period, okay, so a lot of state or enterprise reform, its labor market, or its the governance, etc. But in most part, the job transmit from father to son. Okay, so in most case, the manufacturers. So if your father work in the company, then you have a better chance to get a better position in that company, in that factories. That's not the case for the rural migrants. And the other thing, of course, is more theoretical, is that most employers don't think it's worth to investment in the migrants in long term. For example, they think migrants can stay in the city for a relatively short period, so they don't provide any really, or they do provide some trainings, but the on-job training is adequate, okay, so the human capital investment, they don't have a long-term incentive to provide this kind of human capital training for the local people. All this create the segmentation between the rural and the urban people.
Yeah.
I just have two quick questions or comments. So, do you think this migration flow from rural areas to urban areas, would you describe them as temporary or permanent, this internal migration in China? And then my second question was, you have this variable household size, right? Or family size? So, does that describe the household size back in the where they come from? Because my impression was that most rural migrants live, let's say, in manufacturing sector, they live in like dormitories. So it's like lots of migrants living together in one building versus renting apartments and living with the family.
Yeah, the family size is referred to the family size in the urban areas. Okay, so you're right, there are certainly a lot of people who live in the countryside, for example, in the workplace, like the construction site. But the migrants now are quite diversified. So they're still renting their own apartment, etc. So that's one key. So for your first question, you ask whether the migrants are permanent or temporary. Because in some sense, I just mentioned, it's even until now, it's really hard for them to assimilate into the urban societies. Okay, so most of them are still considered, at least for the relatively old cohort, are still considered go to urban just to, you know, just at the age you can still productive, you can still do the manual labors, so you can earn some money and send the money back to start a small business, or I don't know, to so that's most of them consider a kind of temporary experience in China. So, but now it's kind of changing. For the younger generations, I think the kind of the hope can stay in the city for a longer or permanent period. But the thing is, it's still really hard for them to stay in the cities because nowadays in China, the city is quite expensive because the housing price, etc., etc., and also because the migrants cannot endure the health care provided by the public sectors, and also because if the migrants have a children, then they cannot send their children to the public schools. So they need to send the children to some special school or to the public school, but need to pay additional fees. But all these things are changing. Okay, so it's a big social issue in China now. But the government, the discussion this, but nobody know what will turn out finally. So it's in a transition. Now, the mentality, I think, it's changing. For the older ones, they are more like to think the city as a temporary place. For the younger ones, they are willing to stay in the city longer, but the reality is hard. It's not easy, even for the college graduates. Okay, each year in June, July, the university worry about that the graduate find a job and how can they stay in the cities in Beijing, in Shanghai, etc. So that's true for also for the migrants.
Okay, are there any other questions, comments? Okay, in that case, what?
So you are discussing chances for rural migrants to remain in the urban labor force in the situation of crisis. But how it looks would look if there is no crisis? Clearly, rural migrants in they are often a very unstable part of the urban labor force. What could you say about that?
Yeah, I mean, if we compare the actually, I should give you the first equation. For the people that help them to overcome the financial crisis, that's more rely on the endowment, like the human capital component or social capital component of this scene to help them to overcome the financial crisis. For the mobility of the labor force, that's always true for the migrants. Okay, for that, particular variable cannot really help. In China especially, a lot of migrants just move back and forth. So the attrition without the financial crisis can happen for many other reasons. They are not reflect that you have a poor skill, you have a low capital. Okay, so even for the you have a high skill and you have a high capital, there can be probably have a high attrition rate. For example, you probably can find a better job at other cities, so you are no longer in the samples. So there are two different things. So overall, I think the normal attrition is kind of random, asymptotic about for the characteristic to help overcome the financial crisis is more related to the social and the human capital. Well, yeah, the thing is, that's the, okay. That's why I want to use the bivariant probability, because in the data, we only know the people in the sample or not in the 2009, but we don't know the reason. Yeah, the reason. So it's kind of, in the literature, it's called partial observabilities. If we know the reason, right, it's because of Y1 or because of Y2, then it's much simpler. So that's why we here I use the bivariant probability. The probability? Well, That's the same thing, even if you...
It's very similar.
Yeah, it's the same thing, right. So... No, even for the high can just do the bivalent normal distributions, and you just think that one y is the main equation, the other y is the selection equation. But yeah.
Okay, so can we? So there are no more comments, no more questions, and no more talk now at the moment. No, because I want to announce that we will not have a break. Because we have only one paper. No, we have only one paper left for the thing. But people can, while Anita sets up her presentation, people can go and get coffee and come back and sit at the table. So no coffee break. So I invite Anita to present her paper on the instrument that you get for risky sexual behavior. Okay, so now we start. So, please. Can you turn on the micro? Thanks.
And start again.
Just turn on the micro there, yeah. No, it's at the bottom thing there. That's it. Great.
You might find this paper slightly different from what we just heard. And the paper is about the return to education in Russia, where there is a risky sexual behavior, there is also an instrument. It's with my co-author Reza Arabshaybani, and the title comes from here, from him, basically. I just want to start with a briefly introduction about this means of specification. For those who are not quite familiar, it's just the earning specification where we measure individuals' wage gain from investing in education. So we all know that better educated individuals have higher wages in the labor in the labor market. However, one of the main concerns in the human capital literature is about the ability bias or the unobservability. So basically, we can't measure this. We can measure individual ability, and we know that those with a higher ability may choose to invest in more in education. So if we don't take into account this ability biases, we the ordinary least square estimates may overstate the contribution of education on earnings. There is a number of approaches in the literature to deal with this ability bias. Some of the papers, some of the researchers include direct measure of IQ tests in order to, as a proxy into the earning functions. Some other measure using the twins sample, basically, and in this way they get rid of ability biases. Other popular way to avoid this is by using the method of instrumental variables. So we all know that we need to find, which in the instrumental literature is always critical, the instruments are always criticized, whether they are valid or not. So to be valid, our instrument should determine our schooling outcome and at the same time cannot affect our current earnings. So I want to go within this literature a bit in deep. Some of the popular instruments are like family backgrounds. We know that mother and father education are quite often used into this literature. Some other researchers introduced the colleagues proximately, so these who live closely to the university or to the college are more likely to invest in the future, to acquire future education. Some recent papers introduced smoking as an instrument into this relationship, where they argue that smoking is a good predictor for discount rate, so it's highly correlated with the discount rate and does not influence the earnings directly, and this is what basically makes the instrument valid. So the assumption here is that individuals who start to smoke in their teens or early ages, this is quite related with their time preference, and we consider them as a highly they have high discount rate. So this individual time preference would determine the school enrollment. And as a consequence, as the discount rates are uncorrelated to ability, we could use the smoking as a good predictor and basically to get rid of mobility bias into this urban specification. Following this, the latest instrument, our paper was motivated by one recent paper by Chesson, where they discussed and they proved that young individuals are associated with a higher discount rate, and this is related with associated with a range of sexual behavior. So, given that we take as a given that higher discount rate would mean a higher weight for their current income and lower propensity to invest of education, we try to introduce one, according to my co-author, quite novel instrument. Of course, I would accept your comments on this. So, basically, we argue that this risky sexual behavior at early teen years and their unprotected sexual intercourse could be used as instrument to get rid of ability bias. And basically, we all know that those who start their early sexual intercourse, those who they are more likely to experience early pregnancy. So this could affect their future academic achievements. And again, we should prove that this instrument is valid, which means this risky sexual behavior does not correlate with individual ability to have higher earnings, to get, does not correlate with their current earnings. Just to supplement this, briefly want to mention some of the literature regarding this topic. Basically, Evans and Montgomery argue that much of variation in years of education is generated by educational decision made in these early teen years. There's another paper by Rector and Johnson, which basically I found that this early sexual debate does not necessarily cause the poor academic achievements, but they prove that delaying sexual intercourse is associated with more higher educational aspirations. And again, to support this type of preferences of young individuals, I just want to mention this paper by Reimers, where they show that young individuals desire an immediate gratification rather than just long-term relationship. So basically, this could affect their time preference and affect their schooling outcomes. Again, because introducing one instrument, I just want to highlight that this instrumental variable should be I should go to these two conditions, the relevance and exogeneity. So again, this instrumental variable should affect my schooling outcome and should not affect my current earning, or should affect the earnings only through the channels of education, which I might be a bit precise in this second condition. The data source come from the Russian Longitudinal Monitoring Survey 2001, where I have the sexual behavior module, and I was able to identify my variables of interest. So basically, I match these two modules, and I keep the individuals who only report their wages in 2001. Some briefly descriptive, my outcome variables look of only wages. So I split the sample by male and female. Again, like we can see, males are slightly higher than females. number of years of education is a bit higher for females. I do control for potential experience, being single, having an entrepreneurship within the household, being in a public sector, working for a company that is foreign owned. I do control for so-called wage arrears effect, which is quite important in terms of Russian wage earnings. I have some regions of residence, and basically my dummy, I define individuals who report that they start their first sexual intercourse at age less than 16, so I have about 14% of males and only 6% of females. And my second instrumental variable, again, dummy, where they report that they start that they have unprotected sexual intercourse, is just 1% of the sample. And the methodology is just two stages per model. So my first stage is basically schooling, where ZI is my exogenous variables determine educational decision, or basically these are my instruments. And Z1I is a vector of all exogenous variables that determine schooling.
Sorry, just a clarifying question. The 1% who have unprotected sex are the ones who are 16 or less than 16, or for the whole sample?
It's just 1% of the, let me just go, of the whole sample. And this is my second instrumental variable. And the first are
young people, though, or the whole sample?
Whole sample.
Also, also people who are married.
I exclude, basically, yeah, that's important. Basically, I, how can I, unprotected sexual intercourse for those who report that for those, basically the sample, the data allow me to identify those who report when they start for the first time. So those who start their first sexual intercourse, and I am able to identify that they is unprotected. So, yeah. I go a bit across the distribution by I test these two instruments by applying an instrumental quantum regression model and just to see how heterogeneous is the return to education across the learning distribution. So just some of the tests that I apply is a popular bound 1995 F test of the excluded instrumental variable, so we should find an F statistic higher than 10. I go through some other additional tests which try to support the strongest of my identification by Kleinberg and Paprank Waldwick instrumental statistics, and also the Brioche redundancy test, which basically, because we have over-identified specification, so if in this case one of the instrument is not performing good, we should get rid of this instrument. So this additional test also help us to supplement the results. This is my overall sample. Commonwealth report only the least square estimates, return to education 5.6%. I do report the first stage where my outcome is education, and where my main variables of interest, these two instruments, show very significant and negative effects on the educational outcomes of this overall sample. So it's about on average 1.3% of the sample are likely to for fewer number of years of education. I have significant bound FTS about 34.4, which is above the critical 10. Partial squares, I would say not quite high, but still supporting. We do reject the null hypothesis by this Clyburnian card wall test, and we pass this redundancy test by introducing this instrumental variable. The return to education increased from 5% to 12%, which is typical in this literature, with Ivy estimates are higher than the ordinary square estimates. I test these two instruments again by splitting the sample in males and females. And again, I have this significantly negative effect of these two variables into my first stage educational output specification. And all the tests were passed, which helping to confirm validity of these instruments. Basically, the main argument is that we can't measure exact, we can't estimate whether these instruments are not related with our current earnings, and only way to prove this is by using this Sargon over-identifying test, which again is valid in our case. And by looking across the distribution in my overall sample, again, I just performed the 10, 15, and 19 quantiles. So we have this increasing trend from moving across the distribution. Those are the top of the learning distributions. Gain more from one additional year of education. And again, we test these two instruments. We have significant return to education for those 15 and 19% yield. And the same we found by splitting the sample by males and females. Where at the top of the distribution, the coefficient rise up to 29% for males and 24 females. This paper is still under work, and I know that I can't say we just try to introduce this to variables as one. Additional variables into this Ivy literature, and we support this by saying that these two variables have very strong effect into the schooling outcomes in our first step regressions. So we pass all these tests like over-identifying restrictions, which try to support that these two instruments are valid, they're not correlated with the current earnings, the Sargon over-identification test. And we still have to relate these findings with some policy implications in terms of teenage behavior and how this could affect the future educational outcomes. Any comments are welcome.
Okay, thank you. So, Jean.
I have two comments. One, you said the sexual behavior reflects the discontinuities, and you say discontinuities are not in the earning equations. But if we think the theory of the labor search theory, okay, if you're a high discounted rate person, probably you'll take the wage offer more faster than people who are kind of patient person. That will definitely affect your wage profile. So I'm saying is that discount rate could be a component of the wage equations. Okay, another thing is the such behavior, especially for the teenagers behavior, maybe reflect the risk attitude. Okay, so for the same people with the same observable but only different in the risk attitude, probably the more risk people have on average the higher income, but with a big variance. That will have an implication when you do the quantile regressions. So that, I mean, the six behavior which reflect the risk attitude can also be a component of the wage earning equations.
Yeah, do you have some?
Yeah. Basically, this, yeah, by introducing this discount rate literature, I just try to support, like to say where I'm starting, because this is not a paper which measure highly old versus low discount rate individuals, but you have, yeah, you should consider this. My argument is was starting from this who have that highly discount rate, that they are more likely to, less likely to invest in future education. But in terms of across the distribution in the returns to education literature, always we more likely that those at the top of the earning distribution, if we look at this more able, they're more likely to have higher returns to education. But I should consider this for the discount rate.
Yeah, I think Zhang's point was, would be very useful for you in motivating those quantile regressions, because actually when you first put them up, I wasn't sure. I mean, of course, it's always nice to look across the distribution, but why? But that's a good argument, and your findings are consistent with that interpretation. But I had a different question, just a technical question. What wage variable are you using from the RLMS? What is your wage variable? There are several wage variables on the RLMS. Which one do you use?
You mean how I define the wages?
Yeah, is it the wage paid in the last 30 days? Or is it the contractual wage? Well, so in a time of wage arrears, it probably makes sense to use the contractual wage. And I probably would not control for wage arrears.
But quite sure whether I can remember exactly the name of the variable within the sample, but you mean in the this data set they have different I'm afraid I can't answer exactly on what. So basically I define by wages that they report in the main job when excluding self-employment, but I'm not, you know,
so that's a very volatile variable. People are not getting any wage some months. The next month they might get two wages because they weren't paid the month before. Maybe they get 1.5 times. You can actually see this kind of lumping in the RLMS data for that wage relative to the contractual wage that they're supposed to be paid.
There are there are many studies now where return to education been estimated. And there are two groups of these papers. And one group of papers saying that return to education ratio is high, somewhere around 8 to 10%. There's another group of papers saying that return to education is quite low, 3 to 5%. And your paper belongs to the third group. It's the first, probably, paper in this group which says that it's not high, it's extra high, super high. For the country with such huge proportion of people with tertiary education and limited limited or relatively limited demand and huge over-education problem. So how do you reconcile different things together?
I mean, the findings are different depending what methodology you use. Basically, I found on average 5.6%, but always the Ivy literature tend to be with about 30% higher based on this unobservability, which the paper doesn't aim basically to consider whether it's low and whether the return increase over this. I use basically this data set just to, because they allow me to introduce this instrument of variables, and probably my next step is to find another source of data. So I'm not quite sure whether I can, I haven't done future research in terms of whether this is a bit, but as you say, 5% I think is consistent within the Russian findings. So basically the main idea of the paper is just to introduce this, which is, I agree, a bit unusual way of, but because in the return to education literature at the moment, it's just, we can't contribute in a way, it's just only way to think for something a bit different, and that's why I'm not quite...
Yeah, Alexei.
Two questions. So if you assume that you have ability bias in your returns to education initially, then when you use instrument, you would expect that you receive a lower estimate. So you, initially you underestimate, you overestimate your coefficient, and after IV you would receive a lower coefficient. But then we have to say that it may be another story, not ability bias, but something else.
Basically, if you introduce, as I mentioned in the literature, if you decide to introduce it in the specification, like if you introduce some other measures into the ordinal least square, let's say IQ test, if we have this into the sample, trying to avoid this ability bias, you definitely will get lower coefficient in the returns to education in ordinary least square estimates. That's why I'll just try to say that by using this instrumental variable methodology is another way of resolving the problem. Because, you're right, by including additional set controls, trying to proxy this unobservability, you would expect just instrumental variables literature is a different way of measuring this, and they always, these findings are in line with the literature, they always have a far higher coefficient of return to education. So I've said you don't have to compare all of this with the IV estimates.
The second question is how you interpret your results with quantile regressions. Why in top quantiles your estimates are higher?
If you look at the cross distribution, as again we put at the top top earners of more ability, high ability individuals, you would expect they have higher return to education as compared to the low. It's always quantile regression is a different way of interpreting to look at this heterogeneous effect across the distribution. So normally interpretation is that low individuals are at the lower part, at the 10th, 25th percent of distribution. So I have for them like, let's look at the males, and I have lower because my interpretation is that low able individual, less qualification, and this is the top, are top earners. So this is again different methodology, the interpretation is going in a different direction.
One extra question. I didn't follow. The sexual behavior is self-reported?
Yeah.
All right. So then you could have also an extra problem, which is measurement error. So if people misreport sexual behavior at age 16, which, you know, some people might, and then also, of course, we know that earnings are reported with error. I would expect that people that misreport one will also misreport the other. So then if you have a correlation between these two measurement errors, then that's it. You have endogeneity. In a more constructive, formulating this in a more constructive way, what John L. was saying about using different measures of earnings and trying it out with different measures of earnings, since the ILMS gives you this possibility, could be an avenue to at least check against this.
Yeah. Sorry, I don't think he said you should use different measures of earnings. He said you should use the contractual wage in times of wage arrears. Because the actual wage paid does not reflect returns to education, in a sense. But only if you have a very wide window. So if you look at half a year or something, then you can get what people actually really earn. But if you look at just a monthly window, in case of wage arrears, you might...
You are the absolute expert on this, but so I don't. But in the late, it's true, right? That in the last few years, wage arrears is much less of a problem.
Of course.
But so for the last few years, she could potentially use both.
But she uses a cross section of 2001 only. She only loses 1 year.
Oh, why?
Because only there do you have this question, this module on sexual behavior.
Yeah, I'm quite new in using this survey, by the way, so I even pay for this survey. I didn't know, like, they introduced this free survey to the recently. So, yeah, I should be able to do this. And
just... what I find a bit disturbing in more or less in all earnings or waging equations in Russia is that the results seem to be completely dominated by the regional dummy. I mean, the regional dummy influence on earnings is dominating everything. So
I do control for some.
I mean, yeah. It's always very significant, and the effects are huge. And I think that hasn't really changed a lot. So, I mean, I'm not sure whether that influences or that maybe generates an extra variance in returns to education estimation, because you have, let's say, you have so much noise in this data that have nothing to do with education. So that maybe you have kind of estimation problems in, no? Yeah, it's just a comment, nothing else.
So you use two instruments, right? Is that correct?
Yes.
So, and one is that less than 16 that...
one is... go back just a minute. One is when they report that they start sexual intercourse at age less than 16, and the other one is they report that their first sexual intercourse is unprotected.
Okay, so I mean, so you do the over-identification test, right? Because you have two instruments.
Okay.
But when you have one of the instruments is like 1%. I mean, how can you get any variation to explain what's going on in the schooling, you know? So I don't know what the correlations are between these instruments and the schooling, but I don't think the instrument is driving the results here. I mean, 1% are having unprotected sex.
I'll try separately and see
So I'm just saying, maybe instrument may be relevant, but it's not valid from statistical point of view. You know what I mean? And your the first stage result is like 2%. That's.
The first stage is my second instrumental variable was -1.3 and significant. Yeah, what I can do is just try to separate and see the effects separately. And I just, the only way to test the validity is to apply this over identify.
Sure, and you gotta have more than two or more.
Because if I test them separately, I can't exactly prove the valid. I can say, yeah, they're not weak. I'd say my instruments are not weak. But
I'm sure from 1% of the sample, you have very low correlation. I mean, that's what I'm thinking, right?
For that, I have to check this. I can have to check the correlation.
I mean, they have to be highly correlated, right? Your Z variable and X variable. Otherwise, it's not instrumenting through schooling, it's something else.
Yeah, the instrumental variables are always criticized, so I'm sure, like...
I know the problem.
I think another thing is it would be good if you could relate these results to the literature on Russia, not on, you know, America. Nobody cares about America here, but about Russia. So, because... he also cares about Russia. So I can repeat my statement anyway. But I think
in terms of the findings.
Yeah, the findings, and also in terms of the I guess the institutional setup here a little bit more. You know, I mean, embedding it more into the literature. On the Russian labor market, on education in Russia, because that okay, an instrument, fine, but you know, I think it should be more embedded, and also it should be compared to the results. I mean, Saberyanova, Gorodnichenko have done work on this, which is quite you know, trying to actually they have used some instruments and so on. So, and they have used the panel structure. So. So just to be able to place it somewhere,
yeah,
I think you would need to.
Thanks so much for that.
Okay, so I think we came. Anybody else? Okay, so now we come to the conclusion of the session, and also conclusion of the workshop. So I first give the word to Volodya, and then I will. Have the final word. As my daughter says, I always have the final word, so also here.
So, thank you very much, Hartmut. So we are moving to the end of the conference. We had very dense schedule, just to remind the most important events of these days. The most important event, definitely, it was John's concert. No doubts about it, so that's a second important event. This was award ceremony, no doubts about that. Third, we had a very heavy policy lecture yesterday by Mikhail Rutkovsky. And finally, we had 16 papers discussed. So I think we learned a lot. We got many things to think of. So being one of the organizers, I can say that organizers, at least from the HSE side, feel very happy that everything, probably we are wrong, but we believe that everything goes and gone smoothly, as much smoothly as we could do. So we are very happy, we are very happy to see you here. I hope this is not the last IZA-HSE conference. We are looking forward to see you here again at this conference, other conferences. Thank you to all for coming, for participating. Special thanks to Hartmut, who was real, you know, engineer and driver of this conference. I would, from my side, to also to say say thanks to those who helped us to organize this. Of course, my colleagues who did a lot, and of course, IZA-HSE people who did a lot, and of course, to all of you who also did a lot to make our conference interesting and well going. So that's what I want to say, and Hartmut, please. Yeah.
Okay, so I have to give the compliment back, of course, that thanks to Volodya we have this conference or this workshop, and it was very interesting. So of course IZA will be happy to come back and have another workshop here, or we'll have one in Bonn or in Bertinoro in Italy will be the next one, I think. So let me just finish with this, but let me especially thank Nina because she organized everything here, and without her the whole thing wouldn't have worked at all. And as a sign of token of our appreciation, I have actually two presents for you. One is from Italy. It's basically chocolate from Italy. And the other one, which you might appreciate more, is actually the pen from IZA-HSE. That's it. So now you can announce the program. Okay. All right. Well, let me say one more thing, which is the IZA Journal of Labor and Development. So this is a new initiative by Klaus Zimmermann. So everybody should have this. Now we already have, actually John Earle has already submitted a paper which after an arduous, a very short actually refereeing process, because that's the good thing about this journal, it takes only a month to get a referee report, and you get either accepted or rejected. So basically we want finished papers that have been rejected elsewhere five times, because then the paper is probably good enough to come to us. Anyway, no, but my main point is that this is a journal on labor and development, which is really we don't have a journal about this, and basically it covers transition, emerging, and developing countries. Now my part is transition, emerging economies, those people who have, for example, written papers 10 years ago and they never published it, but it's a good paper about transition. And today people would say, "Who cares about this?" I mean, we care, because if it's a contribution to transitional labor markets or the economics of transitional labor markets, we still will publish it, as long as it's a solid, of course, theoretically or empirically solid paper. Actually, it's not only John Earle. I mean, his paper has already been accepted and will come out now. It's an open access journal, so everybody can read this around the world. But also Volodya Gimpelson has submitted a paper which hopefully the referee will accept, and Francesco Pastore has submitted a paper, and also Zhong Zhao will soon submit a paper. Anyway, just I needed to do this propaganda a little bit, but I do encourage you to send papers to the journal. Thank you.
So before we enter scientific part of the conference, I have to make one important announcement that we are going to have a dinner tonight, at a restaurant not far from here, and all participants of the conference are invited. So this will be at 7 o'clock, The place is called Jean-Jacques, near to Metro Kitai-Gorod. So also foreign participants who have some free time and would like to make, you know, I don't know, walk across Moscow downtown, probably we could do it for 1 hour, let's say in 30, 40 minutes to start with. Yeah, so that's...